One, two, three. There we go. Let me share a few announcements with you as we begin. Marie Cooper is back at Colonial House. She spent some time in the hospital. She was having difficulty with her COPD. And when they brought her in, they checked her for heart problems. Primarily, she said, they didn't pay any attention to what her complaints were. But anyway, she's back at Colonial House now, and so we can keep her in our prayers. Julie Westbrook, Jim and Anna Hart's daughter, is home from the hospital. Charles Sams continues to struggle with health issues, and he'd be more than happy to have some visits if you'd like to go pass and visit him. Some upcoming events: Stepping Stones will be holding their annual community yard sale on the South Campus Thursday through Saturday, and you're invited to be a part of that. Friday Night Sing this week will be at Pennsville, Ohio, and Grafton, West Virginia. Both of those are at 7. We are collecting school supplies next Sunday, the 21st through August the 3rd, for the school store. Distribution of backpacks will be on August the 5th, 6th, and 7th. Zena Hall will be placing an order with Scholastic Books for children's books, so you can see her if you want to order a book for the school store. Sunday evening, PM is the fellowship get-together. Shared group number 2 will be hosting that, so please plan to be a part of it. And if you're in shared group 2, plan to bring us some food. Elijah, Man of Faith, is the theme of our Vacation Bible School this year, August the 3rd, from 9 until noon. Lunch will be provided. We encourage you to be a part of that. There'll be classes for all ages, including adults. Our summer series is going on well. I've heard good comments from those who've spoken so far. We've had some interesting classes. Ron Laughery is with us. He is now at the Mr. at Lynn Street. We know him best from Belpre. He was there forever. But he's now the minister at the Lynn Street Church, and he'll be our speaker this evening, and he'll be dealing with Simon the Zealot. He's also one of those fellows who didn't get a lot of ink in terms of New Testament passages, but he's going to share with us what he's learned about Simon the Zealot. And he said it was really quite interesting to do the work. And so everybody who's done these have said, I learned a lot of things. And so the people who are presenting have learned as much as you will learn, I'm sure. But we're grateful to have him with us. Let's bow for a prayer as we begin. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for the ways that you've blessed us. We're grateful for the blessings that are ours in Christ Jesus, for the joy and peace and hope that is ours. We understand the world around us just doesn't know that and doesn't appreciate that. We pray, Lord, you'd help us to share the good news of Jesus so that others can come to appreciate the blessings that are ours in him as well. We thank you for this church. We ask your blessings upon us as we strive to be a light to this community, to make a difference in the community. We pray you'd be with us as we deal with the school store and Vacation Bible School, as we reach out to the neighborhood to do those things as well. Be with us this evening as we study. Help us to have wonderful open minds and insights as we study together. Be with Ron as he speaks to us. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, it's good to be with you tonight. I appreciate very, very much the opportunity of being a part of this series, and it's always a joy for me to come to 36th Street and have the opportunity to preach. So I don't know whether this is to be preaching, whether this is a Bible class, but we'll just see how it turns out. When Dr. Moss called me a few weeks ago and asked if I would be willing to come and said that the theme for the series was the 12 apostles of Jesus and that I could pick one. Well, by the time he got to me, you know the rest of the story, don't you? And I said, well, what about this? No, they're all gone. And so I end up with Simon the Zealot. I've been preaching now over 60 years. Thank you for telling me that I don't even look that old. But I have never in all of my life taught a class, nor have I ever preached a sermon on Simon the Zealot. Now, certainly in messages that I have given over the years that involved the apostles, I have alluded to Simon the Zealot. So I'll tell you what I did. I preach only every other Sunday at Lynn Street, but I was preaching last Sunday. And so I thought, well, you know what? I'll try it out on them. And we'll see how it goes on Lynn Street and see what their reaction is. And they knew I was coming here tonight to speak. I taught class this afternoon at 2 o'clock there. And we only have one brave soul from the Lynn Street Church here tonight other than my wife, and that's Marge Tigg. And I told her she was a glutton for punishment. But I will say this, that the response that I received Sunday morning was very, very encouraging. So when I found out that I was going to be speaking on Simon the Zealot, naturally I began thinking and I started trying to formulate thoughts in my mind, principles, and then I started reading, I started doing research, and the more I got into this, the more fascinating it was to me. And so I just want you to know that I've been challenged, and I hope that you'll be challenged tonight by the things that I want to share with you concerning this particular apostle. I titled this, Simon the Zealot, A Redirected Religious Fanatic. You have some listening guides, and so if you listen carefully, all of the blanks, the fill-in blanks, will be on the screen if everything works like it's supposed to work, and this will give you something to take home. But let's look at the text in Luke chapter 6 and verse number 12, and I'm assuming we have it on the screen. It was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray. And he spent the whole night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also named as apostles. Simon, whom he also called Peter. There are four listings, and I'm sure you've been told this a number of times in this series, four listings in the New Testament of the apostles' names. In every one of those listings, Simon Peter always stands first. Judas Iscariot is always last. And there is not a total agreement in the four listings. I'm talking about the order that their names appear. And so we're not talking tonight. You probably already heard the sermon on Simon Peter. But there was Simon, whom he called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. Jesus has reached a very critical moment in his ministry. As you begin reading the Gospel of Luke and you get over here to chapter number 6, you become very keenly aware that the opposition against Jesus and his ministry is constantly increasing. And Jesus is aware that in a matter of a few months that he is going to go to Jerusalem and be crucified. And so consequently, he has a very, very critical decision that he has to make. Because he's going to be leaving, he's going to be going back to heaven, and yet there is the building of his church, and there is the proclamation and the spread of the gospel. And so it is a very, very critical moment in his ministry. It is a very critical decision that he has to make concerning these 12 men. So the Bible says that before he selected the 12, he prayed all night. I think this probably tells us something about the humanity of Jesus. He felt so keenly the burden. He felt so keenly the weight of responsibility upon his shoulders at this moment of selecting 12 men from the larger group of the disciples. I think it is safe to say that he is seeking God's guidance and seeking God's direction, and certainly he is wanting wisdom from above. And so the text says that he calls the disciples to him. So this would be the large multitude. This would be the large group. And from this group, he chose 12 to be apostles. So all of the apostles were disciples. But all disciples obviously were not apostles. And so this group of 12 is a very select group. Their ministry was super important because it was foundational to the beginning and the spread of the gospel. I want to share with you just two or three texts. One is from the book of Ephesians. In the second chapter of the book of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul talks about God creating a new humanity through Christ and the cross. I want you to pick up with me in verse number 19. And so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are of God's household. Obviously, we would understand this to be a direct reference to the church. We are citizens, we are saints, we are God's household. But notice what he says. Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. So we understand that Christ built the church, that it is upon the solid rock that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God, that the church would be built. But this text tells us that the church is built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. Christ, the chief cornerstone. Therefore, the choosing of these 12 men is a critical, critical decision, because their ministry is going to involve the very foundation of God's building, of God's temple, of God's house. And then the Gospel tells us that he chose these men so that they could be with him, and that he would then send them out to preach. So in Mark's record of the listing of the 12, verses 14 and 15, the Bible says he appointed 12 so that they would be with him and that he could send them out to preach and to have authority to cast out the demons. According to John MacArthur in his book, 12 Ordinary Men, when Jesus calls the 12, he is probably almost midterm in his ministry. And this would mean that he only has somewhere between probably 18 months and 2 years to mentor these men. And so these men are going to be in an apprenticeship. They are going to live with Jesus. They're going to travel with Jesus. They're going to hear the teachings of the Master. But not only are they going to hear this Master teach, but they are going to see how all of his teachings are lived out and how they are demonstrated in his life. And then he's going to send them out to preach. So when we fast forward to just prior to the ascension, And we read the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, beginning with verse 18. Judas having defected. There are 11 left. And Jesus came up and spoke to them. He's talking directly to the apostles, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Now I want you to stop and think a moment. The world is to be evangelized. The gospel is to be taken from the city of Jerusalem, and it is to be proclaimed throughout the world. And this great commission is initially given to 11 men. Jesus does not have plan B. So what I'm trying to help you to understand, this is a critical moment. This is a critical decision. The church is going to be built. These men are going to be in the foundation of the church. These men are going to be sent forth with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I've got a question for you. Would you have picked these men? Would you have picked these men? Thank you, brother. I wouldn't have either. Probably not. I doubt if there is a search committee in our brotherhood tonight looking for a preacher that would have picked any of these men. Peter. Impulsive. He'll end up denying Jesus right before the death of Christ. Thomas struggles with believing. He doubts. But I would have to say, in all fairness, that Thomas is not the only one in the group that struggled with believing. In fact, all of them struggled with believing, because they never did really get their heads wrapped around the whole concept that Jesus was going to Jerusalem to die and that he would eventually be resurrected. You have Andrew, no notoriety in him. You have Simon the Zealot, the topic for tonight. You have Matthew, a Roman tax collector. You have Judas Iscariot, who is a thief and a traitor. I got a question for you. You look at these men. What is the likelihood of them ever becoming a team? What do you think? Just look at it on the surface. I'm suggesting you do tonight that the likelihood of these men ever becoming a team? Nah. But you know what? They became a team. Now, they did not become a team without a lot of difficulty. And I would suggest to you tonight that they really were never solidified into a team for Jesus until after his resurrection and ascension. Because prior to that, even the night in the upper room when he eats the supper for the last time and institutes the Lord's Supper, you know what they're doing? They're arguing. They're fussing among themselves, vying for position in the kingdom. Who's going to be the greatest? The 12 men are really an odd mix of unlikely characters to succeed. But you know what? they did succeed. It's really amazing. Because in less than 50 years, after they'd been given the commission to evangelize the world, the Apostle Paul would say in Colossians 1 and 23, mission accomplished. So why in the world did Jesus pick these men? So he could change them. That's why he picked them. So he could change them. He knew what they could become. You know, sometimes I find myself asking the same question about my place in the family of God. Why did God pick me? Why did God pick you? Why does God pick anyone? We are chosen. We are called. We are picked to come on a journey with a man named Jesus. And when we're picked, He picks us with all of our shortcomings, with all of our character flaws, with all of our good intentions that often turn to vapor, with all of our desires to be faithful, only to find ourselves many times floundering. All of our sins, all of our guilt, all of our shame. And we're still picked. We're still chosen. And when he picked them, he picked Simon the Zealot. You say, well, biblically, the only thing that I know about Simon the Zealot biblically is Simon the Zealot. That's it. Biblically, I know absolutely nothing more than he was Simon the Zealot. I mentioned that he's mentioned four times in the New Testament. He's mentioned in Matthew chapter 10, 4, Mark 3, 18, Luke 6, 15, the text that I read, and he's also mentioned in Acts 1, 13, among the 120 that were gathered in the city of Jerusalem praying 10 days prior to the coming of Pentecost. So I'm preaching tonight on a man. There's not one word in the Bible ever spoken by Simon the Zealot. There's not one deed that he alone did which was important enough to make the pages of Scripture. Not one mention of works he did. No mention of miracles he performed. No mention of sermons he preached. One author said that Simon the Zealot is the most obscure of the 12. Now, if you're tracking me, and I need to keep watch of the clock, that's my introduction. And so, someone said today, said they would only give Ron Laughery a subject like Simon the Zealot to preach 40 minutes on. So here's what I want to do. I want us to briefly look at the pre-disciple life of Simon. And then I want us to look at the disciple life of Simon. And then I want to share with you some lessons for today. Okay, so what is a zealot? Let me give you a general definition. It is a fanatically committed person. That's it. And so in your mind, as you listen to this tonight, you just think, generally speaking, a zealot is a fanatically committed person. This is a person who is uncompromising in their pursuit of their religious or political or other ideals. Now, that's a general definition. But we need to understand, and we need to be able to look at the meaning of zealot from a historical perspective. And so let me give you a historical definition. Historically, a zealot was a member of a first century movement that fought against Roman rule in Palestine. Josephus talks about the various sects that lived in Palestine during the life of Jesus. He talks about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and he's going to mention the Herodians and the Essenes that are not mentioned in the New Testament, but they lived there. And he mentions the Zealots as being one of the prominent religious sects of the Jews in first century Palestine. Zealots, during the time of Jesus' ministry, hated, I want you to listen to me, they hated the Roman oppression under which they lived. They were super patriots who swore on their lives that they would resist Roman rule at all cost. The early historian Josephus says they were dagger men. Put that in the back of your mind. A zealot was a dagger man because they would just as soon drive a dagger into the heart of a Roman as to look at them. Let me tell you how they operated. They would sneak up behind Roman soldiers and Roman politicians and stab them in the back with a dagger, going between their ribs. And my research says that they expertly pierced the heart of their victims. From their headquarters in Galilee, they carried out guerrilla-style warfare and terrorist acts against the Romans. Today we would say that they were religious terrorists. Their motto was, "We have no king but Jesus." The zealots were convinced that paying tribute to a pagan king was an act of treason against God. You got something to think about that one. Let me just detour here for one moment. You remember Jesus was asked about paying taxes during his personal ministry, took a coin, had the image of Caesar on it. He said, "What? Render to Caesar that which is Caesar's, and unto God that which is God's." The zealots would have really had a tough time with that one. And so, listen, these people were insane. They were ultimately self-destructive. Are you hearing me tonight, church? This fella is one of the 12 apostles of Jesus. Before he became a disciple, he's a daggerman. I just tuck that away. I'll come back to it. So, let me give you these bullet points. So, before Simon became a disciple of Jesus, he would have been, number one, he was a freedom fighter who always carried a knife. Number two, he was a willing participant in organized crime against the Romans. Number three, he was a person with a killer instinct. Number four, he was a person who wanted revenge at any cost. Would you have picked him? Would you have said, you know what? This is one of the fellows that's going to make a great preacher. Probably not. It's amazing to me that Jesus would choose a man like Simon the Zealot to be one of his apostles. Let me tell you what this tells me. Listen carefully. The choosing of such a man to be an apostle shows me the depth of change that Jesus Christ brings into our lives. Let me say that one more time. The choosing of Simon the Zealot shows me the depth of change that Jesus Christ brings into our lives. The choosing of such a man brings us back to the very heart of Jesus and to the very heart of the gospel. So Simon the Zealot becomes Simon the Apostle. So let me share with you just a few points about his life as a disciple. First, he was convicted, he was converted, and he was commissioned. And you say, well, Ron, how do you know that? Because you just got done telling us the only thing you knew about him was his name. The reason that I know tonight that he was convicted and converted and commissioned is because this is what happens in the life of every person who chooses to follow Jesus. You get it? If you make the choice to follow Jesus, you are going to be convicted. Convicted of your sins. Convicted of your lostness. Convicted of your need of forgiveness. But you will be converted. Your life will be rotated because your inner being, because the very core of your being, your heart, has been changed and transformed by Jesus Christ. And eventually, you will be commissioned. So, as I think about his life as a disciple, he's convicted, he's converted, he's commissioned. Number two, he was changed from being one who hated to being a member of a community of love. Jesus would say in John chapter number 13, by this all men shall know that you are my disciples. If you what? If you love one another. You see, Simon was transformed by Jesus. Do you know what he would have done to Matthew before they met Jesus? Do you understand this tonight? He would have put a dagger in Matthew quicker than you could say. He would not have flinched. He would not have given it a second thought for one moment to have finished Matthew off. He had put a dagger right through his heart. You say, Because Matthew was a Roman tax collector. He was collecting taxes for the Roman government. And these zealots they were out to get everyone that aligned themselves in any way with Rome. Can you imagine a finger food fellowship on Sunday night in Jerusalem with these fellas? I'm telling you, Simon the Zealot and Matthew the tax collector are at opposite ends of the political spectrum. They became spiritual brothers. They became two people that were working side by side for the same cause, the spreading of the gospel. Jesus Christ radically changes hearts and changes lives. Number three, Simon's zeal was redirected by Jesus. You see, Simon was ready to die for Israel's deliverance from Roman domination. But Simon the Apostle came to experience a more glorious deliverance when he was drawn to the Lord Jesus Christ. And through the grace of God, this man's zeal is redirected, it is rechanneled, it is refocused. And he has a zeal for Jesus Christ and for the kingdom of God. I believe that Jesus saw in Simon the Zealot a man with fierce loyalties and an amazing passion and courage and zeal. And once he was convicted and once he was converted and his life is transformed by the Master, his loyalties are redirected. His amazing passion redirected. His courage, his zeal redirected. What was the focus of Jesus' ministry? Let me tell you what it was not. The focus of Jesus' ministry was not political. The focus of Jesus' ministry was not overthrowing Rome. Now, yes, I understand that they were looking for a revolutionary political Messiah that would come and conquer Rome, and that's not what Jesus was about. And so the Messiah arrives and he begins to tell people, I'm going to Jerusalem, I'm going to die. That's what he came for. He came to die. Because there was a world that needed to be saved. He came to die because man needed to be forgiven. The focus of Jesus was the kingdom of God. And he would say, my kingdom is not of this world. He would say, my kingdom is not political, but rather my kingdom is spiritual. And so I'm suggesting tonight that Simon the Zealot became a redirected religious fanatic. And the next thing that I would suggest is that he became a part of a band of brothers. And this just warms my heart. It really does. A band of brothers. All the apostles, some of them were literal brothers, James and John, Peter and Andrew. All were brother Israelites and descendants of Abraham. But let me tell you, these men, with the exception of Judas, all of them became brothers in the family of Jesus. And I mentioned a moment ago about the listing of Matthew and Simon the Zealot and Judas, and in Matthew's gospel and in Mark's gospel. And there's some Bible scholars that think that when Jesus sent them out two by two in Mark chapter 6, that it was likely that Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot made a team. I don't know whether that's true or not, but it's very plausible. Let me tell you why. Because probably both Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot initially followed Jesus for similar political reasons. Let me say that again. They probably initially followed Jesus for similar political reasons. But Simon became a genuine believer and was transformed. And Judas Iscariot was never transformed. And in spite of their ideological differences, these men became a band of brothers working together for the greatest cause in the world. None of them were at the cross, with the exception of John. Now, I would say to you tonight that these apostles found a new purpose. And the deserters of the cross became the defenders of the cross. So real quickly, lessons for us. And I'll not have much time. I'm supposed to quit here. I'm going to take 7 minutes. I'm going to go 10 till. Okay, thank you for that liberty. Lesson number one for us: we are called by Jesus so that he might change us. Change begins in your heart. The Bible calls it repentance. My dear friend, you'll never be what God wants you to be, and you'll never become what God wants you to become until your heart has been changed. And when I talk about change, I'm talking about a radical, drastic change. And that's really the essence of discipleship. That's really what it means tonight to become a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. He changes us. I would suggest to you that the apostleship was a melting pot. God took these men, and he melted them. He molded them, and he transformed them into what he wanted them to be. I would suggest to you tonight that the church, the family of God, is a melting pot. God melts us, and then he molds us, and he shapes us into the people that he wants us to be. Lesson number two: God calls ordinary people and uses them in ministry. Oh, have you ever been discouraged? Have you ever been disheartened about your place in ministry in the kingdom of God? I would say to you tonight, take heart. Because Jesus calls and he appoints ordinary people to serve in the kingdom of God. Jesus selected the 12. Now, I would suggest to you tonight, not because of extraordinary talents, unusual intellectual abilities, powerful political influence, or some special social status. I'm saying to you tonight that these men, whom Jesus called from the larger group of disciples, were common men. I love the chapter in John MacArthur's book on these 12 ordinary men, uncommon men, a common calling. Jesus did not choose one single rabbi. He did not choose a scribe. He did not choose a Pharisee. He did not choose a Sadducee. He did not choose a priest. Listen to me. Jesus Christ did not choose one person from the religious establishment of his day to to be an apostle. Let me make another statement to you. He chose men who were not theologically trained. Fisherman, a tax collector, a zealot, just common, ordinary men. But let me tell you what God does. God takes sinners and He saves them. He sanctifies them and He transforms them from unqualified into instruments that can be used in the kingdom. Lesson number three. The family of God is so diverse. You see, when you think tonight of the church, the family of God, people from different backgrounds, different cultures, different religious perspectives, different characters, different experiences. But let me tell you what God does. God brings us all together. And He says, I'm going to give you a new purpose. And that purpose is to glorify Me and to make disciples and to go proclaim the good news to everyone. As diverse as we are, Scripture says we are one. I am one with Jesus Christ. And because I am one with Jesus Christ, I am also one with all of you. And Paul put it this way in Colossians 3:11. There is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. Lesson number four. We must have a zeal that has been transformed by Jesus Christ. You can be zealous for wrong things. Paul talks about his own people in Romans chapter 10, and he said that they had a zeal for God, but it was not according to knowledge. And so let me just very briefly mention, you can be zealously building your own little empire, constantly putting everything on hold, including God, and sometimes, you know, you just say, well, I just want a little bit more. Someone asked a multimillionaire, how much would be enough? And he replied, just one more dollar. You can be zealous about building your reputation. You're constantly working at pleasing everybody, and you want everyone to like you, and sometimes you find yourself compromising with God in that process. You see, when our esteem in the eyes of men becomes more important than our integrity in the eyes of God, then we're zealous for reputation. And we might be zealously making ourselves indispensable. Or you try and do everything on our own. We take satisfaction in being told, you know what, that wouldn't have happened if it hadn't have been for you. But when help is offered, we politely refuse because nobody can do it better than what I can do it. So we're zealous, but we're not zealous for God's work because we're wanting all the credit. Oh, we need to be zealous tonight, church. But our zeal needs to be transformed by Jesus. We need to be zealous in putting Him first, and we need to be zealous in showing compassion and concern for others, and we need to be zealous in making sure that the gospel is more important than anything else, and we need to have a fervent zeal in sharing Jesus and the gospel with others. There are three closing points. I'm going to hold those until we have the invitation, okay? Thank you for listening. Oh, am I to do the invitation now? Oh, well, I thought we were going to do something else. Okay, well, I guess then, let me share this as we wrap all of this up tonight. These three points at the end, Jesus calls us to be disciples regardless of where we are in life. I want you to hear that. See, it doesn't make any difference about your journey, friend. It doesn't make any difference where you are. It doesn't make any difference what you've done. It doesn't make any difference how bad you've messed up. Doesn't make any difference to God how many times you've fallen flat on your face. No. Scripture says that you come to God where you are. You don't fix it. You don't put your life all together and then come. No, my dear friend, you come broken. You come ruined. You come to God as a condemned lost sinner. And the second thing is, He changes our hearts and He transforms our lives. Just think about that. We come by faith to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, and He changes my heart. And you know what? When He changes my heart, He transforms my life. That's the result of a changed heart. My words are changed. My actions are changed. The way I live, my lifestyle, it's all different now because I've become a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. So let me ask again tonight, why did Jesus choose you? See, I'm going to assume that probably nearly everyone listening to this is already a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so at the end of the day, why did Jesus choose you is really not the right question. The question now is, how are you going to live as one who has been chosen? As one that has been picked? As one that has been called? How am I going to live? And how are you going to live? You see, Jesus calls the Simon Zealots of this world. And He says, I can use you. And there's a place for you in the kingdom. I'd have read a couple of the different things in preparation for this about Simon the Zealot. Some say that he eventually went to Egypt to evangelize, was martyred in Persia, but then came across someone that said that he went to the British Isles. I don't know, but let me tell you what I know. Let me tell you what I know. These men that Jesus called to be apostles, they went. And they turned their world upside down for Jesus Christ. They proclaimed the gospel. Churches all over the known world of that day were planted. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people became followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so our mission in our world tonight has not changed. We have been called by God, and we are sent by God to make disciples. If you're not a disciple of Jesus, it's the greatest moment in your life when you choose to become a follower. You do that by faith. You're not trusting yourself. You're not trusting your good works. You're not trusting anything that you've done, but you're trusting solely the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ to save your soul. And as you place your faith and your trust in Him, your heart has to be changed. You have to repent. Unless you repent, Scripture says you perish. And because you believe, you become totally unashamed of Jesus that you're embracing and following, and you say with your lips what you believe in your heart. I believe He's the Son of God, and I want Him to be the Lord of my life. And then there comes that very special moment when you are united with Him in baptism, when you by faith reenact His death, burial, and resurrection. And oh, it's not the water. There's no virtue in water, no power in water. But it's the precious blood of Jesus. As you come in contact with that shed blood that washes all of your sins away. And you're raised to walk a new life in Him. And then He gives you the gift of the Holy Spirit that will enable you and that will empower you for the rest of your life to be an overcomer in Jesus Christ. Tonight, if you have never given your life to Jesus, then we'd love to hear you confess His name. We would be thrilled to watch and to witness your baptism into the Lord. You may be here tonight and you're just struggling with life. And whatever that may look like in your life, we would like to encourage you to come and let this church cover you tonight in prayer. Maybe you've walked away from the Lord. You see, that's what Judas did. He walked away and he never came back. I tell people, I've said this in many sermons, there's a major difference between Simon Peter and Judas Iscariot. Simon Peter denied Jesus, and he got up. Judas Iscariot betrayed him, and he gave up. I'd like for you to get up tonight. Do you need to respond in some way to this invitation? If you do, you come while together we stand and sing.
Kneel at the cross.